Imagine if you go through all the rules, fill out all the forms and the paperwork, get all the licenses, and buy a legal firearm. And then some years later, the RCMP just suddenly declares that same gun illegal and demands that you hand it in without compensation. Crazy? Well, it just happened. And joining us now with the details is our friend Solomon Friedman, a firearms law expert. Welcome back to the show, Solomon. Tell me about this RCMP decision to buy their own device, not through Parliament, not through a court order, just suddenly decide that a kind of gun that has been lawful for more than a decade is now prohibited.
Well, the firearm at issue here is the Swiss Arms rifle, which is a fairly expensive gun, runs between $3,000 and $4,000 new. It's been in this country for a while, more than a decade. And when it first came in, the RCMP, as they do for every firearm that comes into the country, they classified it. And they classified it largely as non-restricted. That means it could be owned by anyone with an ordinary license, it could be used for hunting, it could be used for target shooting, it could be used in the wilderness, etc.
Now let's just stop for a second. A $3,000 to $4,000 firearm, I actually don't own any guns myself. I should probably remedy that, Solomon. But as guns go, this is sort of an elite model. This isn't a gun that any, you know, ruffian on the street would hire. First of all, they're not going to buy a long arm. They'd buy a pistol or a machine gun. Second of all, this is something that you'd have to be a real aficionado, a bit of a connoisseur, probably a middle-aged, wealthy collector. Like, this isn't a gun that bad guys use. Am I right?
No, not only is it not a gun that bad guys use, it's sort of a Rolex of guns. Besides being Swiss-made itself, it's really a fascinating, you know, piece of design and of firearms history. There are a lot of very legitimate reasons. It's a very accurate rifle. It's great for hunting. It's great for target shooting. And it was, relatively speaking, for a gun of this type, widely owned.
So I just want to ask you one last question before we get to the meat of today's show. As far as you know, I have no idea, but I just am going to guess that this gun has never in history been used to commit a crime in Canada. If it was fairly rare, very expensive, and a bit of an elite long arm, I'm guessing it's never been used criminally.
I think that's a safe assumption. I think the only thing that's been shot with this likely are animals lawfully hunted and paper targets at a range.
Okay, so tell me the news. And you brought with you the firearms. Tell me the name of this document. This is an RCMP document where this ban, this prohibition was declared to the world. Tell me about it, and let's quote from it.
Yeah, this database is the Firearms Reference Table, and it's where the RCMP sets out the classification for every firearm in Canada. Now, had you looked at this Firearms Reference Table a week ago and looked up this rifle, it would have said that it is non-restricted. This morning, that all changed. A new comment was put in the file, which will have significant repercussions for Canadians.
So this is the comment here. I'll just read it. In 2013-14, a thorough inspection of the Classic Green family of firearms, which included this model, has determined this model to be a variant of the firearm commonly known as the SG-550 rifle, and is therefore prohibited under, and then it just says how it's prohibited. So they say they did a thorough inspection last year, even though they thoroughly inspected it more than a dozen years ago. Why would they do this? Like, why would they suddenly say, oh yeah, when we told you it was one thing, now we think it's something else? What would motivate this? Like, as far as we know, this was not treated by Parliament. This was not a court order. There was no public consultation. Just some person said, I want to check that thing I said okay to a dozen years ago. Oh, I checked and it's no longer legal. How would it have gone down?
The answer is a little more complicated than that, and it's a little more nefarious as well. This is not the action of one person. Firearms owners have long been on notice that there are many categories of firearms that the RCMP would like to prohibit, but they can't because they lack the legislative and regulatory authority to do so. So what we have here has actually been a concerted effort to find firearms. We saw in that picture of the firearm, this has a military-like appearance. And those are guns that, on a doctrinal basis, the RCMP is opposed to. They're no more dangerous than any other kinds of guns.
It just looks scary. So, if it looks scary, we're going to ban it. Now, what does this mean to someone who spent $3,000-$4,000 on this? I mean, it looks like a Rolex of guns. That's what it looks like. So how would this go down? Someone knocks on your door, shows a badge, say, I'm here, I'm a cop, I have a search warrant? Do they say, give it to us? Or how's this going to go down? I mean, how's this even going to get out to people who, like, it's not like a car recall. I get a notice in the mail, my car has a recall from the manufacturer. How would you even tell people this is now illegal. You're turning law-abiding people on Monday into criminals on Tuesday. How would they even know?
Absolutely. You know, and it's very, very interesting here. This is actually where the issue of the gun registry comes into play. You know, gun control advocates always say, we just want registration. We don't want confiscation. But of course, we can see very easily here that by having a registry, it leads to the confiscation of firearms. Because without a registry, you don't know where those guns are that you have now banned. But in this case, yes, if one owns this firearm, they'll likely receive a letter, either because they've been tracked down through a retailer or by some other method. They'll receive a letter saying, turn it in for destruction, challenge it in court, or you're a criminal. Those are your only options.
Now, here's the thing, and it reminds me of what happened in High River when there was a flood and police opportunistically took the occasion when people were out of town to literally smash down more than 1,000 doors to go looking around for guns. And they did this in places where there was no flooding. And the working theory, and I think it's a very credible one, is that the police have confidentially, secretly, illegally retained a copy of the firearms registry, and they actually know where these guns are, and they're using it despite Parliament's command that this list be destroyed. Last thought to you. We're almost out of time, Solomon. What do you think of that? Is that how the RCMP may track down gun owners?
I think it absolutely is. I've seen in other areas in my practice where it appears as if they have a copy of the gun registry data. If many firearms owners start getting letters in the mail, people start, you know, contacting them by name and address, then I think we have that confirmed. They have not destroyed the data that Parliament explicitly said they had to in violation of the Act.
You know what? And this undermines our support for the reputation of law enforcement. If they themselves pick and choose what laws they follow, it undermines the reputation of the justice system for all of us. Great to talk to you, Solomon. Keep us posted on how this goes.
Thank you.